Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 9th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff present that social distancing rules apply in the Parliament, and if you are moving around the room or entering or leaving the room, if you could wear face coverings, please. The first item for the committee to consider is whether to take agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The next item on our agenda, agenda item 2, is consideration of the 2020-21 audit of the Scottish Environment Protection Agency. And I'm pleased to welcome our witnesses this morning, all of whom are online, and in so doing, they're joining our Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who is also online this morning. But can I welcome the Acting Chief Executive of SEPA, Joe Green, Stuart McGregor, who's the Chief Finance Officer, David Peary, Executive Director, Evidence and Flooding at SEPA, and from the Scottish Government, we're joined this morning by Roy Brannan, who's the Interim DG for Net Zero, Helen Nisbet, who's the Director, Defence Security and Cyber Resilience, and Kevin Quinlan, who's the Director of Environment and Forestry in the Scottish Government. Can I begin by just reminding people that we are quite tight for time this morning, so I would appreciate if there could be both succinct questions from the committee and succinct answers. Could I also suggest that the committee is taking evidence on the 31st of March on major ICT projects in general, at which point we will be looking at some of the wider read across from the cyber attack which SEPA sustained and the lessons that we need to learn. So I'm going to try and encourage people to be as disciplined as possible, but our line of questioning takes that into account as well, hopefully. Could I say as well to Roy and to Joe, please feel free to bring any of your colleagues in if that's helpful to you, and to those colleagues who are online, if you want to come in at any point to give us evidence in relation to a part of the conversation we're having, then if you put R in the chat room, and we will pick that up when appropriate. So can I begin by welcoming Joe Green, who is the Acting Chief Executive of SEPA, who I know had hoped to be here in person this morning, but is joining us virtually. And Joe, could I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. So SEPA was the victim of a determined and sophisticated cyber attack orchestrated by international serious and organised criminals. The attack has had a significant impact on our operations and our ability to deliver our full range of services. The loss of access to data also impacted on our ability to report for the 2021 financial year, including our annual report and accounts. Our focus throughout our response and recovery has been on protecting the environment and communities and protecting and supporting our staff, ensuring the most critical service delivery on flooding and environmental regulation, and building new rather than building back in a way that sets us up better to meet future environmental challenges. A key aim was to learn from the cyber attack on us and also share that learning. In October, we published and shared widely independent reviews we had commissioned. We've also implemented 35 of the 44 recommendations made in the reviews, with good progress on the remaining 9. We're now more than 12 months on from the attack. Service delivery remains very challenging, but our staff are still delivering important work for the environment and communities in difficult circumstances. Have now stabilised our most critical systems and are making good progress in the difficult and complicated job of recovering data. There's still much more to do. Experiencing such a sophisticated criminal attack has been very difficult for our staff. I want to go on the record to thank them all for their commitment, flexibility, hard work and resilience. We're also grateful for the support provided by the Scottish Government, Police Scotland, the National Cyber Response Centre and Scottish Business Resilience Centre. Before I close, there's just one point I would like to clarify from the evidence at committee on the 10th of February. One of the questions raised was about just 1.6 gigabytes of data being stolen, and that didn't seem to be that much. I'd just like to clarify that while only a very small amount of our data was stolen and published illegally on the dark web, the attack left most of our data inaccessible by encrypting and deleting both our data and the systems that enable us to use those data. It is this that made the attack on us so significant. I'll lead for SEPA on answering questions today, joined by colleagues, and thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And for that last point in particular, I think that's a very helpful clarification. And I know that later on in the session, Willie Coffey will have some questions around that subject in particular. But I want to turn, first of all, to Sharon Dowie, who I mentioned earlier on, is joining us through video link, who's got a couple of questions to start us off with. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. We know that the cyber attack is subject to an ongoing police investigation. However, are you able to confirm if investigations are ongoing to establish the exact root source of where the cyber attack breached SEPA systems? And also, once those investigations are complete, will that information be shared with us, or will that remain confidential?
And so, yeah, thank you for that question. I just want to say we had a high degree of cybersecurity maturity, but the attack on us was very sophisticated. It is, as you say, subject to a live criminal investigation. There's only a certain amount that we can say about the routes in, but I will just pass to David Perry to talk a bit about this. So thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, as Joe said, it was a highly sophisticated attack. We have undertaken a number of reviews of the attack. One of those reviews was a technical forensic review, which has informed the Police Scotland investigation. We have published, well, we haven't published that technical forensic review as it's part of the criminal investigation. The headline the methodologies and the headlines of how the attack happened are published in the SBRC review. The exact route into SEPA's systems and the particular phishing email that originated the attack has not been identified, but the forensic investigation did identify that it was a phishing email that was the most likely source into SEPA's systems.
Okay, thank you. In paragraph 14, it states that the SEPA staff member received a system alert at midnight in the morning of the 24th of December, and they were unable to reach the key senior management contact to escalate the issue at this point of time. The Auditor General has told us that you've reviewed your immediate response protocols following the cyber attack. Are you able to give us a brief outline of the changes that have been made as a result of this review?
Yes, thank you for that. And just to be clear, SEPA has a strong culture of resilience, governance, incident and emergency management. And all of that kicked in around the incident and quickly. But I'll just pass to David Perry again just to talk specifically about what you've raised.
Yeah, as I said, we've taken on board those reviews. They've got 44 recommendations. We're working our way through those recommendations. We've reviewed and renewed, updated all of our cyber response procedures and playbooks as to how we initiate and undertake response to incidents. But I should say on the evening of the cyber attack, our response was effective and did work to plan.
So you're happy with the responses that you've got in just now? You're happy that your new procedures wouldn't have the same issues that you had on the night of the attack?
I don't think they would have the same, and I don't think the escalation was material to the impact of the attack. I don't think it made any difference to the attack. But I am confident that our new procedures are in place and are will be effective going forward. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, convener.
Thanks, Sharon. As I mentioned earlier on, Willie Coffey has now got a series of questions. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everybody. Joe, you've already said that you've made progress in the recommendations that you had to undertake. You've done 35 out of the 44. So I wonder if I could just explore the issue of the backup issue. We know from the previous paperwork that the backup data was first targeted, as I understand it, and that rendered that inoperable and you couldn't perform a backup. Could you tell us a wee bit, please, about the current backup situation and whether your recommendations or your actions since then have addressed that particular issue to make sure that the data is entirely separate from the main system's data from now on?
Yeah, thank you. And yes, I mean, this is obviously a key issue in terms of cybersecurity. And I would just stress the attack on us was really sophisticated at the time. It had a number of components to it. Had implemented what was at the time best practice in backup policy, but it specifically targeted backup systems as our team tried to recover and restore backups. And yes, we have made a number of changes. And so what I'll do again, I'll pass back to David Peary to talk about some of the detail of that. So thank you.
Still online.
Yeah, I think we're having some problems with David Peary's connection. I don't know. He doesn't appear on my screen at the moment. We were going to try and put him onto audio only, but I don't think David appears to be there. So, Joe, I don't know whether there is anyone else in your team that could pick that up, or whether I'm going to ask Willie to move on to his next question.
I don't know if it's possible to come back to it, because David Peary would be so good at answering this question, and so I don't know if it's possible to come back to it if we manage to connect back to David.
That's fine. I mean, one thing that we've always got the option of doing is asking you to provide us with a written response to any of these questions if you're unable at this point to answer them to the fullest extent that you would like. So, but anyway, I'll go back to Willie.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Joe, I mean, you don't need to tell us, or David doesn't need to tell us the details of any of this. It's just to provide the assurance, I think, to the committee members that the backup strategy is different from what it may have been before, and it's more secure, because we all know that another phishing email can come in any day, and staff can inadvertently access it, click it, link it, follow it, or whatever it is that occurs. So it's just to get a sense from you that we have recognised that particular issue and that steps have been taken to provide additional protection to the systems data that we have.
So, yeah, I mean, we had three levels of protection around backups. And yes, it was in line with best practice at the time. And yes, we have made improvements since based on the recommendations that came forward in the audit. Just to give that assurance.
Could I just press you on whether you want to tell us, is there a physical separation now between the systems data and the copy backup data that the organisation would have? Because that, to my mind, would mean that any further attempts of a similar nature cannot succeed if the backup data is physically separated from the main systems data.
Yeah, we did, as part of that kind of 3-2-1 best practice we had at the time. There was some physical separation in one layer of our backups. And so that was already there. But again, what we'll do, if David Peary is able to join, he'll come back in on some of the detail, or we'll follow up with the committee in writing just to clarify that.
Right. OK, just briefly then, convener, just in what kind of support has SEPA had from the Scottish Government to help me get through this by way of either staff support or any financial support or otherwise to recover and move forward? And sharing those lessons, other organisations, not just SEPA, are vulnerable to this kind of attack. So have you been able to share your experience with other bodies to make them aware of the possibilities and the actions that you've taken that they may wish also to consider implementing?
Yes, thanks for that. And so in terms of support, and then I'll go on to learning, on support, we're very, very grateful for all the support that kicked in really quickly on the back of this attack. Again, it was a very serious criminal attack on us, and it was so significant. And Scottish Government moved very quickly to support us. For instance, you know, we had 120 Scottish Government secure laptops, you know, that our most critical staff, including our emergency team, had access to. So we're really grateful for that. And again, on the finance side, colleagues working really closely with Scottish Government around that. So we had some really strong support in the early days, including especially from Police Scotland, the National Cybersecurity Centre and Scottish Business Resilience Centre. So enormous support around us as we went into that early stages of response around the cyber attack. In terms of the learning, yes, we were really, it was one of the first things we landed on. It was so serious, and we just thought, right, we can learn from this, but actually others can learn from this as well. And it's why one of the reasons why we commissioned those four independent reviews, and they were for us to learn from, but then we shared them very widely. We had an event back in October, and we've made that really public in terms of the lessons for us. And what was good in the reviews as well, including like the Police Scotland one, it made recommendations for us, but most of those recommendations are also for other public bodies as well. And so it was really clear for other public bodies what they could take from what happened to us.
Thanks very much for that, Joe. If David comes back online, I might...
He is back, Willie. David Perry is back online. So.
Maybe just pop back to
of him. Course, you want to ask. Yep.
Hi, hello, David. I can't see you on screen, but I was asking about the backup strategy and whether you could give the committee some assurance that the backup procedure going forward will, as far as we can, make the same type of cyber attack on you impossible to succeed next time round by physically separating your data, your backup data, from the main system's data. As I understand it, the hack reached to the backup data firstly so that you couldn't reinstate your systems. So in order to prevent that, have you taken steps to make sure that separation of backup data from main system's data is as a physical one, as a separate one, so that it can't be attacked with any future attack that might take place?
Yes, we have. We had a well-developed strategy for backups. The reviews have indicated that we broadly complied with best practice. We had three layers of backup. We had a synchronous backup, a real-time synchronous backup. We had off-site backups, and we had what's called air-gapped backups. When the attack happened, they began encrypting our data, and as they encrypted the data, they in real time copied that to our synchronous backup. So that synchronous backup became encrypted in real time. Our off-site backups, the criminals actively targeted those off-site backups and deleted those off-site backups. Our air gap backups covered some of our main data sets, but they didn't cover all of our data sets. Since the cyber attack, we've taken on board the recommendations and we've put in place new backup arrangements that cover all of our data in offline backups.
I appreciate what you've said there, but could you just please confirm to me that should something of a similar nature occur again, the backup data cannot physically or logically be accessed by any hackers that may wish to do that? There has to be a complete separation of your data in order to protect it from future hacks.
Yes, I can confirm that.
Great. Thank you. We've lost your image as well there. But thank you very much for that, David. I'll go back to you now, convener.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm just conscious of the fact that Roy Brannan is on the panel as well, and I know that the role of the Scottish Government was mentioned in that question. I don't know whether Mr. Brannan wants to come in on that question before I turn to Colin Beattie for a series of questions. Roy, do you want to come in?
Thanks, convener. Yes, I think as Joe said, from what I can see, before my time as DG, but I'll bring Helen in, who was there at the time. But there was a lot of activity, close working, really early doors on the day on the 24th. We had the on-call cyber resilience unit contacted early doors, and then the chief information security officer engaged, who both then established the National Cyber Incident Coordination Arrangement. And that kind of flowed through the day on the 24th. But as well as providing the laptops, the secure email accounts, the IT support, we also allowed access to the cyber incident response company that provided that early help to SEPA in that space. And also the uplift in the budget for 21-22 of £2.5 million, of which SEPA didn't use the entirety. But it was the support, I think, from the sponsor team was pretty good in those early days and continued throughout the year with regular kind of engagement with SEPA's management on 20 performance measures that we were tracking in terms of trying to see the organisation recover. But Helen, I don't know if you want to speak a little bit more about the early response from our cyber colleagues.
Sure, yes. Thank you, Roy. Yeah, I mean, I think, as you've already said, we, you know, really from the word go, I think it was 11 o'clock on the 24th, that both the Chief Information Security Officer for Scottish Government and the on-call cyber resilience team were notified by David of the incident. I think it became quickly apparent that it was of such a magnitude that we needed to stand up the incident management plan, which we did. I think the critical thing about the incident management response company coming in is obviously in the early stages of an attack, you need to get to grips as to just what has happened. So there's always a bit of time required just to do that diagnostic work. But by the time we had the first cross-working meeting on the 27th, which brought in the National Cybersecurity Centres, Police Scotland, the sponsorship team, and of course SEPA colleagues, even by that stage, we had already started to push out across the broader public sector in Scotland, and indeed beyond that, because obviously we're feeding into the NCSC as well, you know, what we were understanding about the attack, in order that other companies and organisations could look to see if there was any similar activity happening in their own area and take appropriate action. And we continued that work throughout the kind of the weeks following the attack.
I'm going to bring Willie Coffey back in for a final question.
Just to ask you, Helen, are you content that should there be another successful attempt, cyber attack attempt, that the backup data this time cannot be accessed and encrypted, destroyed, stolen or otherwise?
Mr. Coffey, I'll say it from my own point of view. I'm not a technical expert in these things, but what I will say is I think that the action has been taken in accordance with the recommendations, and we're satisfied. So now, I mean, as you'll appreciate, there's a constant cat and mouse game around this kind of area of activity. It's almost in some quarters, it's almost as if it's a game or a challenge to those who are trying to infiltrate systems to overcome what measures are in place. So that's always the challenge we face. But you know, certainly I'm satisfied, you know, from the reports we've received that SEPA have taken steps to meet the challenge that was and to meet the vulnerability that was exposed in the attack.
Thanks very much indeed. And just to say that for the remainder of the session, David Pirie will be with us, but he'll be with us audio only. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, there's still some distance to go in terms of recovering data and so on. Do we have any feel for how much data is still to be recovered? How many systems remain to be either re-established or developed as a workaround? Do you have anything on that?
Thank you. And so on that, we're really obviously really concerned about data in the early stages of the attack and what could be recovered. It's very difficult and complicated work, but the headline on that is we estimate that over 80% of our data now has been recovered. Now access is still limited because you still need to be able to have the systems to be able to access that data. Actually, really good progress is made on recovering that data. I'll pass to David Pirie to talk about some other aspects that you've raised now.
Yes, We've successfully recovered just over 80% of our data. The data that we have recovered includes all of our email correspondence, a large proportion of our finance and HR records. Most importantly, it includes the raw environmental data of things like ecological, chemical, hydrological and discharge results that really is represents the raw data that is our understanding of the state of Scotland's environment going back for almost 50 years. So we have recovered all of that data, recovered that data. But there are systems that we have still to recover, and there is obviously about 20% of our data that remains encrypted or deleted and inaccessible to us. And it is going to take some considerable time to rebuild the systems to give us free and easy access to the data that we have recovered, because recovering in itself is the first step, but the second step is then building the systems that allow you to have access to that data.
Just to make it clear in my mind, when we say data has been recovered, does that mean that data that was encrypted has been decrypted? Or does it mean that the information has been rebuilt, perhaps using manual records?
None of the data has been decrypted. We do not have decryption tools. We didn't pay the ransom, and as such, we don't have any decryption tools. When I say the data has been recovered, it has been recovered from offline backups, the sort of backups that we were discussing earlier on. It has been recovered mainly from offline backups. Some of the data has also been recovered by restoring it from sources or locations that were unimpacted by the attack. So some of the data has been recovered from our website or from publicly available locations. Some of our data has also been recovered from manual paper type records that we held.
So none of the data has actually been decrypted. Don't we have resources that are capable of doing that, or is it just simply too difficult?
It's my understanding that it's too difficult, and we certainly haven't managed to decrypt any of the data. Occasionally, decryption keys do become available when criminal groups either fall out with each other or if they get caught by law enforcement agencies. It's not impossible that a decryption key will become available for us, but the advice that I've had from law enforcement agencies is that it's highly unlikely that we will get a decryption key.
Okay, just carrying on the same line, are there any services at the moment or projects that you're unable to provide or deliver?
So I can come in on that. Yeah, no, sorry, I was making sure I was on camera and live. So, yeah, thanks for the question. So in terms of service delivery, it was challenging in the immediate aftermath of the cyber attack. But, you know, our business continuity arrangements kicked in quickly. We were able to quickly move to be able to do our flood risk service, flood risk warning around incident response, around our regulation. And so our most critical services could kick in within a day, you know, so very quickly those kick back in. And then we've really been on the kind of phased planned approach to recovery around our services. And in the early stages, that was really about stabilising really basic stuff, you know, bringing our staff back online so they could actually communicate and have access to email systems. And you know, so that took a period of time. It was about getting those very basic services back in place. And that's been a gradual planned approach to all of that. What we did quite early on is put weekly service updates out there on our website that people could see the status of our services over time. And so over time, we brought our services back online. But at the moment, you know, it's still really challenging to deliver because we still do that build of new systems to make it easier to operate within the organisation.
So at this moment, there are no services that you're not providing?
And so one of the services that we're not providing would be, normally would have a public register, but this relates back into the data recovery. So we're not currently providing a public register. But again, we'll have got a really planned approach to that data recovery and bringing things back online. We need to re-establish our public register.
Are there any projects, for example, that have been seriously impacted, either delayed or put on the back burner as a result of this attack?
Well, clearly, I mean, after the immediate phase of the attack, we pulled together a plan for the year annual operating plan. And we had a series of projects that we were doing to deliver and build back. And we've kept largely on track with that during the year. I think just the efforts and flexibility of our staff to deliver in very difficult circumstances has continued throughout that year. And just to give you some highlights of what we still managed to do, we've done COVID in wastewater monitoring. You know, we've kept our labs going. We've managed to do that. And that's our expertise in designing and implementing monitoring networks, coupled with our scientific capabilities, enabled us to do that and contribute that to the response around the pandemic during this time. On water scarcity, we're responsible for the forecast and monitoring of Scotland's water resources, and we produce a water scarcity situation report weekly between May and September. And again, we managed to keep that going. And similarly on bathing waters, you know, we successfully monitored Scotland's designated bathing waters. So in terms of key headline areas of priority, we just continue to deliver during the year, but it was extremely difficult.
But you haven't actually said if there's any services at the moment that you're not able to deliver.
Well, the public register is one. See that as a really important service.
Anything else?
And we will be getting it back online.
Are there any other services that are impacted?
I think it's mainly different ways of delivering services rather than it being impacted. So, for instance, we have a really significant role on responding to planning consultations, working with planning authorities. And clearly, in the early days, we'd lost access to our data, our files. It was really difficult in terms of that initial communication. But what the planning service did was very quickly kicked in to have direct links into each of the local authorities to triage what's the most important stuff that we need to get onto to providing advice to you. And so that's what kicked in around our planning service, that cleared the backlog. And actually, it's established a different way of operating with the planning authority that we plan to carry forward. There's been a lot of ingenuity and workarounds in difficult situations, but some of that is stuff we want to continue in the future.
And just one final question. You've, I believe, established a figure of 17.9 million being the potential worst case scenario costs. Are you able to firm up on the cost to date and any projections that you might have, both in terms of the cost of the recovery and your responses to that?
Yes, and so, I mean, in terms of the cost of the cyber attack itself, we're doing work to pin that down, and we do intend to publish that, make that available, and that should be by the end of this month. You know, it is imminent. We're doing all of that detailed work now. Now, clearly, it's not necessarily straightforward because, as I say, we're not recreating all of our old systems. We're building for new, and some of that would have been investment we would need in the coming years anyway. And so it's quite tricky to pull together the accurate cost of actually the cyber attack itself. But that's what we'll do, and we'll try and lay it out as transparently as possible so that people can see it. But maybe just check and see if Stuart McGregor, our finance officer, would like to come in on this as well.
Yeah, thanks very much, Joe. Can you hear me okay? Yes. That's great, thank you. In terms of, I'll maybe answer the question on the £17.9 million first. This was based on a report that was carried out, or a paper that was prepared in 2019. And that's, as you know, normal practice, we would do some forward financial forecasting over a number of years. There was a number of forecasts in there in terms of potential reductions in grant funding and potential increases in grant funding. So there was some wide ranges in there. It was just to give board and the management team a feel for, you know, the potential challenges we may be looking, maybe facing in the future. But you know, the 17.9 was out there in terms of, you know, the worst case scenario we should be looking at. That's not coming to fruition. You know, we've had flat cash settlement budgets in the main for grant and aid. Well, that does add some complexities in terms of having to cover, you know, wage awards and inflation, etc. It's certainly not out towards the 17.9 million value that was quoted in the report. In terms of the on-year finances, you know, we're looking okay. The 2021, we didn't need to utilise the 2.5 million from Scottish Government, so we operated well within that. Current year, we're looking that we'll be there or thereabouts in terms of the forecast outturn against the planned budget. And you know, we work closely with Scottish Government sponsor and finance units in terms of forward forecasting. So the 17.9, it's not a figure that worries me at the moment. We're nowhere near approaching that figure.
Correctly. There obviously are costs. That's mitigated to a certain extent by SEPA accelerating delivery of its digital strategy, which presumably is within your budget in any case. So the actual impact on your budget, and I'm not putting words in your mouth here, but the actual impact on your budget should be much less financially.
Yes, that's the case. I think you summed it up well there, basically, that, you know, we look at the annual allocation that we get. It's a one-year settlement, and we're working within that. We prioritise, you know, the budget strategy in terms of delivering the priority outcomes for SEPA. So, you know, we're not anticipating major gaps going forward. There will be challenges across the public sector. I believe there will be challenges with the funding availability. But in terms of cyber, you're correct in terms of moving forward. We had the digital strategy. We're having to bring some of that forward. So we're reprioritising our spend within the year to do so. And we're phasing over the period of time.
Thanks, Mr. McGregor. That's helpful. Can I just go back to Jo Green on a point that she made a few minutes ago? And Jo, you told us that the one service that wasn't currently available as a result of the cyber attack was the public register. For the layperson, could you just explain what information is captured in the public register, and therefore what is it that we can't see that we normally would be able to see? And when do you expect it to come back online?
Yeah, so our public register is where we make available all the information on our permits that we issue. And in terms of when it will come back online, I might check with David Pirrie, but we've had a planned approach to data recovery. We're just going into that next phase of planning. And so to set out what we're going to recover when. So I don't know if we could say exactly at this point exactly when it will come back online, but I'll check in with David Pirrie to see.
So we're bringing our services back online in a phased manner. So some of the services are back online already. So some of our licences, things like septic tanks, some of our waste carrier notices, some of that are online already. But it's going to be some considerable time before we've got all of our services back up and online. When I say considerable time, I do mean years. It's probably going to take us at least a couple of years to get all of our services back up and online.
Wow, well, that's that is quite a stark conclusion to draw, isn't it? I'm going to now bring in Craig Hoy, who's got a series of questions to put to you. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Ms. Green. Obviously, the impact of the cyber attack is significant and will be felt right throughout the organisation. So I'd just like to turn briefly with three questions in relation to staff training and future workforce planning. But just from the outset, I suppose it would just be quite interesting. You all seem to be in quite good spirits this morning, but if you might want to say a little bit about the impact of the attack on staff morale and how that is being that has been managed since December 2020.
Yeah, and I'm actually really glad you've asked that question. It's been uppermost in our minds on the exec team throughout. And again, I just come back to being the victim, being victims of such a significant cybercrime has been very difficult for staff, especially set against the backdrop of the pandemic and what everyone was already going and dealing with, personally and professionally. And SIBA has a culture of resilience governance, incident and emergency management. So we're used to responding to incidents, but this, you know, the level of extraordinary flexibility and commitment going even beyond that culture was quite something. And this happened, you know, on Christmas Eve. The people who voluntarily just gave up their leave, who just kicked in, and then over many months, you know, have carried an awful lot. We've talked about, you know, that loss of access to data to some of our services. But actually, we still have the skills and experience and ingenuity of 1,300 people in the organisation. And that's what has allowed us to actually keep operating services without some of the systems and data that we've talked about. What did we do? I mean, we did a whole range of things. What was absolutely critical was communications. And so we kicked in, you know, straight away, communicating with our staff weekly, sometimes more frequently than that, pulling our managers together weekly as well to support them in order to be able to support staff. The communications was a huge focus so that people knew what had happened, know what was happening now, what's coming next. So that was a major focus. It was really critical to actually just bring our staff back online. Because people had lost that access to email, to everything, and the ability to communicate easily. That phasing of bringing people back online over a period was really important. We also, you know, again, this was a crime. And so, you know, understandably, there was staff concern about actually, you know, some of the data had been stolen. And also just those protections to staff. We made available antivirus software for their own use at home. We had great guidance that Police Scotland pulled together to help our staff understand how the actions they could take to protect themselves. And so we had a number of supports from the organisation and from others. And also just to mention Unison's efforts throughout this time. We have a strong collaborative working relationship with Unison within SIBA, and the support that they provided to the organisation was absolutely key. We gave them a seat actually at the table on emergency management team meetings. All staff calls and managers' calls. And so they played a significant role throughout as well.
Thanks. Obviously, as a result of the SBRC review, there was quite a high awareness and training. I think 95% of staff had undergone cybersecurity training in 2020. Could you just say a little bit about how you've approached the issue since the attack to raise awareness and to develop skills over the emerging risks and the future risks in relation to cybersecurity among staff?
Yes, thank you. And so, yes, we had, you know, a good level of cyber awareness within the organisation already. And as Police Scotland said, we're not a poorly protected organisation in terms of cyber. Training for staff is absolutely key. Again, I'll pass to David Peary to talk a little bit about the staff training.
Yeah, as we brought our staff back on board, as we redeveloped our new systems, we had an induction session for every staff member that went through do's and don'ts. It utilised the National Cyber Security Centre's security training, so all staff members went through that security training. Actually, just this week, we have purchased new cybersecurity training, and we're just about to launch a second wave of cybersecurity training for our staff in the forthcoming month. So, as everybody was brought on board following the incident, they went through training, and actually in this month they're going through a second set of cybersecurity training.
Thank you. Perhaps if I could just put this question both to Mr. Peary and to Helen Nisbet next, obviously from a SIBA and a Scottish Government perspective. I think Helen described it earlier as a kind of game of cat and mouse, and obviously getting cybersecurity getting increasingly sophisticated. What impact is that having on workforce planning to ensure that public bodies, SEPA and the wider public sector, have the skills that they need to make sure that they can not only recover from this attack, but make sure they safeguard against future attacks?
Maybe if I could kick off.
Yep.
Cybersecurity is it's an increasing threat. It is an increasing threat, and as indicated earlier, it is a game of cat and mouse. And there are two elements of our cybersecurity training. There's the general training that we talked about earlier for all staff, because staff are the best and first line of defence, so keeping them aware and keeping them aware of the broad threats, that's one area. But there is a second area, which is the more detailed advanced training for our IS specialists to keep threat of the emerging of all of the new and emerging threats. I'm pleased to say that since the SEPA event, we have seen increased support in that second area from Scottish Government. Since the SEPA cyber attack, there's been regular forums held by Scottish Government cyber professionals where they are sharing intelligence, learning and approaches for some of our cyber security staff to make them aware of upcoming threats and things that they need to be aware of, and that's proved very useful in recent months.
And perhaps Helen, perhaps if you yes. want to comment on that.
Sure, thanks very much. As David's obviously described the kind of the SEPA experience of this. I mean, I think from our point of view, we rely heavily on the strategic framework for a cyber resilient Scotland that was launched in February 2021, and that built upon the original cyber security strategy that was published in 2015. There's a multifaceted approach we're adopting here. I mean, rather than having a strategy that needs to be reviewed every few years, what we have is a framework that can just be built on with successive action plans. We've got four action plans covering 21 to 23 activity just now that runs, really seeks to achieve the same things across public, private and third sector in terms of, the four overarching aims are that, across all the piece, people recognise cyber risks and are well prepared to manage them, that businesses and organisations recognise the cyber risks and are well prepared to manage them, that digital public services are secure and cyber resilient, and our national cyber incident response arrangements are effective. But within that, as I say, there are action plans working across public, private and third sector for that. There's also a training and skills action plan. And I think that is, there's kind of key things that we're trying to bring through there is that we're embedding cyber resilience and understanding of the need for cyber resilience really through the education system, starting with schools, obviously going through into further education, higher education, so that this that general awareness is established. But also we're looking to see what we can do to establish that pipeline of skills that brings properly qualified cyber resilience and cyber security people into the workforce. Because as David has said, and as I think I said earlier myself, this is a growing problem and it's unlikely to diminish. We just do one last thing in terms of the what support we've been offering in the time after the attack. Again, there's a number of products that are made available by the National Cyber Security Centre that allows businesses to kind of self-assess how their cyber resilience is. There's a kind of base, a foundation level known as cyber essentials that allows organisations to kind of self-assess. There is a higher level of cyber essentials plus, which is basically self-assessment, but it's then, if not accredited, there's kind of cyber sort of technical challenges brought in that allows organisations to be tested on their understanding to see if there's any weaknesses. there is a product called Exercise in a Box, which is a kind of almost as it sounds, it's kind of a kind of packaged exercise that can be utilised by organisations to test their understanding. And we have supported both financially and through public awareness the use of that across Scotland in the last several months, and more recently, and probably just touching upon current events around Ukraine, we have via the Public Sector Cyber Resilience Network that is established, we have been doing sessions that just raise again, they bring raise the awareness of the current kind of heightened level of risk that we're in as a consequence of events in Ukraine. And we have set up daily a kind of daily information sharing cell just to ensure that we're picking up on anything that is happening. And we've also been able to engage with the Scottish Government Chief Information Security Officer to kind of offer kind of surgeries to public sector, primarily just to ask any particular technical questions around our current cyber resilience needs. Thank you.
That's reassuring. Thanks. I will hand you back to the convener. Thanks.
Right, thanks very much indeed. And some of these broader themes, as I mentioned earlier on, will be picked up in the evidence session that we've got planned for the 31st of March. But that brings us to the end of our short evidence session on the SEPA report. So could I thank once again Joe Green, Acting Chief Executive of SEPA, Stuart McGregor, David Peary, who joined us both visually and audio only at points. But thank you very much for the evidence that you've given us, which has been valuable. And to Roy Brannan, Helen Nisbet and Kevin Quinlan from the Scottish Government, who also joined us this morning. So can I thank you? If there are any additional points that you feel on reflection it would be useful for us to have, then do by all means submit those in writing to us. We would receive those gratefully. But I'm now going to briefly suspend the committee so that we can have a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Well, can I resume this morning's committee meeting with our next agenda item three, which is a discussion about the Audit Scotland report into the NHS in Scotland 2021. I'm delighted that we are joined in the room this morning by the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Welcome. And alongside the Auditor General is Lee Johnson, who's a senior manager at Audit Scotland, and Derek Hoy, who's an audit manager at Audit Scotland. Eva Thomas-Tudor had hoped to be with us, but unfortunately is not able to attend. But Auditor General, can I begin by inviting you to give us an opening statement? Then we've got quite a wide range of questions to ask.
Thank you. Good morning, committee. I'm pleased to bring this report to the committee on the NHS in Scotland for 2021. Last year's report focused on the response to the pandemic. This year we turn our attention to the recovery and remobilisation of NHS services, whilst acknowledging that the NHS remains under severe pressure from the pandemic and the backlog of patients that has built up over the past 2 years. We've seen the NHS start to emerge from the immediate impact of COVID-19, but it remains on an emergency footing, and the path of the pandemic remains unpredictable, as we've seen with the Omicron variant towards the end of last year. The Scottish Government and NHS are planning the recovery from the pandemic, but the scale of the backlog will make that very challenging. The NHS must reform. Services were already delivered in an unsustainable way before the pandemic. The Scottish Government must focus on transforming health and social care services to now address the growing cost of the NHS and its recovery from COVID-19. Improving the NHS, though, will be very difficult against the competing demands of the pandemic and an increasing number of other policy initiatives, including plans for a national care service and meeting net zero targets. The Scottish Government and NHS also need to prioritise prevention and early intervention in their recovery plans. The innovation that we've seen during the pandemic shows that positive change can happen quickly and effectively, and that momentum has to be maintained. The Scottish Government published its NHS recovery plan last year and is developing a care and wellbeing portfolio to provide strategic direction for its reform, but it needs to involve the public in deciding how future services will be delivered. We've identified workforce availability and wellbeing as the biggest risks to recovery. Staff wellbeing has been affected hugely by the pandemic. The Scottish Government and NHS have introduced measures to support staff, but it's still too early to tell how effective these will be in the longer term. In addition, the NHS recovery plan makes ambitious commitments and places some big asks on the workforce, already at risk of fatigue and burnout. The impact of those ambitions on staff wellbeing must be monitored carefully. The recovery plan requires a significant growth in the workforce. These are on top of existing commitments. A new health and social care workforce strategy was published last week, and we'll now consider its contents and the NHS's progress against it through our future audit work. It remains the case that plans to recruit and retain staff are ambitious and will be challenging to achieve. Historically, the NHS has struggled to recruit enough people with the right skills. Our report also notes that the availability and quality of data across health and social care is a major risk to recovery and reform. That includes data on primary care, community and social care, workforce and health inequalities, all of which are crucial to planning and scrutinising how services will be delivered. Convener, as you know, I'm joined today by Lee and Derek, two of the authors of the report, and between the three of us, we'll look to answer the committee's questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And we'll press straight on with a couple of questions which Sharon Dowie has got, who's joining us remotely. Sharon.
Good morning, and apologies for not being there in person this morning. Bullet point 3 of paragraph 6, the report states that the Scottish Government has committed to supplying PPE free of charge to the NHS and social care services until at least March 2022, but it's not clear what the arrangements will be after this date. Do you have any update on this?
I'll probably just quickly turn to Lee in a second, Deputy Convener, just to see an update on that. I think that this comment really is consistent with the point we noted in our PPE briefing of last year about the government's plans for future will be key, not just for NHS settings, but also social care, given the role that the government played in stepping in to support health and care providers across the country in the provision of PPE. So we note that it's a real necessity for clarity for all providers as to, given the significance of it. And as we've seen, as we touched on opening remarks, that the pandemic's still in place. You know, there are still variants, and all that will have a bearing on what that means for all health and social care settings. If Lee has an update, you know, she may be able to provide. If not, we can follow up in writing.
Thank you, Auditor General. You may be aware that the Scottish Government has issued a consultation about PPE, particularly interested to hear the lessons learned and put in place a clear strategy for future arrangements, and they've committed to do that by the end of this month. And within that consultation document, it does say that they anticipate that the provision will extend beyond March 2022, but it's subject to discussion with the delivery partners. So I think we're still waiting on an update, but I think there is a commitment that it will extend beyond the end of this month.
Okay, thank you. Also, measures to reduce delayed discharges during the first wave of the pandemic between December 2019 and April 2020 were effective in the short term. So could you outline what these measures were? And also, delayed discharge continues to be a huge problem. So what do you believe needs to be acted upon now to achieve a longer term solution to the problem?
It's such an important and long-standing challenge, I would say, Deputy Convener, in the first instance, and I'll bring colleagues in a minute about some of the circumstances that led to the reduction in delayed discharges that we cover in the report, and also how those have grown back again, really, over the course of the pandemic to relatively similar levels. There are three factors that we touch on in the report that kind of lead to delayed discharges, whether they're in a health and social care setting, some of the circumstances that patients and their families find them in that lead to a complex set of circumstances that can result in people being provided with care not in an appropriate setting, effectively what a delayed discharge relates to. We note in the report that this needs a concerted plan from between the NHS, its partners in local government and the third sector, so that the delayed discharges that effectively this committee and committees across the Parliament have been considering really for many years, we move on from being an ongoing feature of the delivery of health and social care. I think it is the case that, and I'll turn to colleagues just to say a bit more about the circumstances at the early stage of the pandemic, that there was a rapid discharge approach. Undoubtedly, there will be pros and cons to those circumstances, and I think it's inevitable that some of that will be considered in the public inquiry that follows as a consequence of the COVID-19 pandemic. So we note that, and of course we'll be aware and track that and consider what that means for future audit work in this area. But I'll turn to colleagues if there's anything more that we wish to say about some of the numbers.
So I think in terms of delayed discharge, at the start of the pandemic, there was a rapid discharge strategy, which was very successful. But that was a temporary arrangement, and after that, we did see the numbers rise back to what they'd previously been. And that's been the case pretty much ever since. We've seen them creeping back up. There was a slight decrease over the winter there, winter 2021, after some additional resources had been put towards further measures to reduce delayed discharge, but I did check those figures the other day, and they started to creep back up again after winter. So I think there's definitely no kind of permanent solution yet, and we're still seeing, there's definitely an issue there that still has to be resolved.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned earlier about workforce issues. So in paragraph 20, it refers to the 2021 Royal College of Nursing Employment Survey, which found that 40% of staff worked beyond their contracted hours in most shifts, 67% were too busy to provide the level of care they would like, and 72% were under too much pressure at work. What steps are the Scottish Government taking to address these issues?
There are some very significant statistics in the paragraph that you quote, Deputy Convener, about, I suppose, the overarching impact that the pandemic has had upon health and care workers. The numbers that we quote in the paragraph we draw from the Royal College of Nursing survey, so they relate specifically to nurses, but I think it's safe to say that the pandemic has affected all health and social care workers across the piece. And I think in our report last year, we drew on some of the work of the BMA and some of its own conclusions. In terms of the actions that the government has taken, I think we note that there are steps around helplines, additional rest areas, some provision of meals and so forth as a means of mitigating some of the impact. The longer term benefit of those and whether those will be long term plans, I think, remains to be seen. And we'll, of course, expect the NHS to continue to evaluate what that means.
I think the power has been restored. Therefore, Auditor General, could I bring you back in? You were telling us about the findings and the evidence that you'd looked at in the whole area of staff wellbeing and the surveys that have been carried out by people like the Royal College of Nursing into the views of their members.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think we note really, as the Deputy Convener asked in paragraph 20, drawing on some of the survey results from the Royal College of Nursing about the impact that the pandemic had on their members and some of the steps that NHS had taken to mitigate that impact. I think it remains to be seen, Convener, the extent to which that will have a long-term bearing. We look to the future in the report as well and note that the remobilisation and the recovery plan will draw heavily on existing and new staff to deliver NHS priorities and recover against the backlog. All of that will be key to ensure that the risk of fatigue and burnout that NHS staff are already experiencing isn't exacerbated by the implementation of what we say are ambitious and challenging plans.
Thank you. I mean, the report draws to our attention, I think, additional funding that's been made for the express purpose of attending to staff wellbeing, and I think the figure is £8 million and £4 million. Doesn't sound like an awful lot of money to me compared to the overall budget of the National Health Service. Do you think that's, is it addressing the scale of the challenge which is there?
I'll bring colleagues in a moment if there's anything they wish to add about some of how the government, I think, the NHS rather, intends to evaluate the impact of this spending. There's no denying, Convener, that the relativity of these amounts compared to the overall NHS budget are small, and some of those will be about culture and management as well as additional spending. Our assessment is that it's probably too early to tell what the impact of these will be, but with all of the challenge that we've seen upon NHS workers and guarding against the risk of increasing that pressure as we look to recovery, that the NHS is clear what bearing it's had that these schemes are having on their colleagues. I'll maybe turn to Derek or Lee, Derek, if you wish to say a bit more.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yeah, we did look at the government's arrangements in place around these new measures that have been introduced to support staff wellbeing. We were quite satisfied that they were robust and that there is a plan in place to evaluate and monitor the new measures that have been introduced. That, as the Auditor General said, it's very early stages. These are measures that will have a long-term effect, so to know how effective they are just now is really not possible. What we do know is that generally over the piece, engagement with the measures that have been introduced is quite good, with the exception of maybe the telephone helpline, which is maybe understandable given the nature of the way that people might want to seek out support. But generally speaking, there has been a good response to those. Early feedback suggests that those measures that have been introduced are having a positive effect and that people are benefiting from engaging with those services. What we have said in the report is that what we need to see is for the Scottish Government and NHS to continue to engage with our workforce to ascertain whether or not these measures are the right measures, whether they cover the breadth of support that is needed across the workforce. But I think for now, as much as could have been done has been done, but there is a job still to do going forward to monitor and evaluate that.
Because again, as I read the report, Derek, there is a short life working group being established. I mean, is that sufficient to properly monitor the impact that these measures are having?
I think that working group is part of a range of different groups that have been set up to monitor this, so that there are other arrangements in place as well that are going to be more long term. So I think, yeah, there is, although there is that one short life group, the rest of the arrangements in place are from what we determined, they are quite robust and suitable. But obviously, that remains to be seen if that remains to be the case going forward, and we'll hopefully keep an eye on that.
Yeah, we shall keep an eye on these trade union and Royal College surveys in the future to see whether there's a move backwards or forward. I'm going to now bring in Craig Hoy, who's got a series of questions about that element of the report, which looks at diagnosis and treatment backlogs. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Ball. Obviously, we know that the treatment and diagnosis backlog has got significantly worse because of COVID, but COVID's not, in many respects, the principal cause. NHS boards around Scotland are now working to try and tackle that backlog, but you do refer to the report in the report that this is still significant. So are you aware of any health boards in Scotland that are making good progress in this area? And conversely, are there any health boards where you have concerns about the pace in tackling the backlog?
Yeah, I'll bring Lee and Mr. Hoy in a second to elaborate on the local geographic circumstances that we're seeing. If I may just draw the committee's attention to Exhibit 4 in the report that really sets out across a range of indicators the impact of the pandemic. And I think you rightly note that, you know, that there were challenges in NHS capacity before the pandemic, but we're seeing really an increase in demand, a reduction in activity and longer waits as a consequence of the pandemic and the circumstances that the NHS is now facing to tackle the backlog. Other contributing factor I think we'd also point is that as we saw over the course of the pandemic, fewer people presenting in the numbers that had historically been the case. So there is a missing cohort of the population with undiagnosed illnesses that will inevitably present as years to come. Unfortunately, that's likely to be with illnesses further progressed than they would have been and the urgency that brings. The NHS plan in terms of tackling the backlog relies significantly upon the presence of national treatment centres and the recruitment of more staff to provide the services in these centres. Some of the national treatment centres are already in operation, so the Golden Jubilee Hospital is classified as one of those, and that there are other plans to increase capacity around the country to do so. This is the central component of the NHS recovery plan, that these centres are up and running, and the timing of that varies across the country through to, I think Lee will come in with some of the detail on this in a moment, to 25-26. So long to medium term plans really to deliver those. How that translates into regional variation, I think it's probably too early to tell, okay, kind of if we've got a clear picture as to whether patients around the country can expect variation or whether there'll be a national picture, but Lee maybe wish to say a bit more.
Thank you, Auditor General. I guess we didn't look at any boards particularly. We looked overall, but I think one of the main points is that, as we say in our report, in November 2020, the Scottish Government published a clinical prioritisation framework. And in our 2020 report, we asked for that data to be published. And again, we've made that recommendation because that data is still not available. And that's really the data that will start to give us an idea of how different NHS boards are tackling their waiting lists and waiting times and how many patients are being seen and when. And that data is still not available.
Okay. Just a question I asked NHS Lothian last week. I'm just wondering if you've got any way of assessing this or measuring this. Do you know how many patients may have chosen to go through the independent sector to self-fund treatment during the pandemic? Is there any way of capturing that data other than just simply when their appointment comes up, they then or they elect to drop off the waiting list?
I'm fairly confident that we don't have that analysis, and it wasn't a direct feature of our assessment of the waiting list and whether there was a clear, evident, comparable group of the population that weren't featuring the numbers that would have been anticipated. If NHS Lothian or individual health boards aren't able to provide that, Mr. Hoy, then perhaps the other route would be through Public Health Scotland, that the committee may wish to explore. As you would expect, we'll look again at our own data to see if we have that information. If we do, we'll share that with the committee.
Okay. Obviously, the report included the recommendation, as you said, Ms. Johnson, to publish data on waiting times based on the categories in the clinical prioritisation framework, which is being progressed by Public Health Scotland and NHS boards. What role is the Scottish Government playing to implement this recommendation? And if the information hasn't yet been published, what more should be done to ensure that we manage to get that data out there?
We have spoken to Scottish Government and Public Health Scotland about the data, and they hope to publish it soon, is what they're telling us. They're just working on, as with any kind of new data set, about the robustness and reliability of that data. They need to be sure that the data is robust and reliable before they publish it and make it publicly available. And they are taking steps to make sure that's possible. And they've promised us it will be soon, but we're still waiting.
Okay. Obviously, the issue of GP appointments has been in the news quite significantly, both in terms of face-to-face appointments and appointments soon near me, for example. It seems to be that the report is highlighting that data on the number of GP appointments carried out is not yet available. And this obviously means that it's difficult to determine the true number of people who avoided seeing their GP during the pandemic and who therefore may be effectively storing up health problems for later that could present in a more extreme way. Do you know why this data is not available? And do you believe the Scottish Government should be doing more to gather and disseminate that data?
Well, this can come in a second, actually, to say about the point about why the data is not available. But Mr. Hoy, you and the committee will recognise that this is a recurring theme of our reporting about the need for more robust data around all aspects of public services, but how important it is in the consideration of the NHS and the future of the NHS and different service models, that it will be key to determining how best to reform the NHS to have a clear understanding of current demand and future demand patterns. So we note that, yes, you rightly point out GP, but really across primary care aspects of acute settings as well, that the quality and connection of data isn't as strong as it needs to be. And it's a key recommendation from our report that the government and the NHS to make progress in doing so, to give it many of the more levers, scrutiny and to track progress for its reform agenda. But again, Lee may be able to say a bit more about the point about GPs.
I don't have a great deal to add other than, again, saying that this has been a recurring theme for us. We cannot get access to the activity and demand in GPs. They have, over the years, tried to implement different systems. You know, we've been waiting on the Spire system, here we are, and still we don't have access to that data. The only thing I would maybe flag is in the new health and social care workforce strategy, one of the commitments that the Scottish Government have made is to do an annual survey of GPs, and that may give us more information, both about the workforce, because again, it's another area that we don't have a huge amount of data. It is about the staffing in GP practices either, but that may give us more access to data going forward. But obviously that hasn't been implemented yet. And of course it is a survey and all the challenges that can bring to.
Yeah. One of the sort of stark statements in the report, which is paragraph 45, says that the scale of delayed diagnosis and treatment and what this means for NHS services and patients is not yet known. And to try and make progress in relation to that, you recommend that a cohesive strategy is needed to better understand the wider health impacts of COVID-19 on the NHS and to inform future service provision. Do you know if the Scottish Government has any plans to develop such a strategy?
We know that the as you suggest, it will be for the government to determine. You know, it's our understanding they have accepted the recommendations in the report, whether it's a standalone or featured as a dedicated strategy, the government will be able to advise Mr. Hoy. The importance of it is key, though. You know, if you look at as we've touched on already, the delayed diagnosis has such significant health consequences for the longer term. Along with, the report broadens out into the unequal impact of the pandemic, both in terms of delayed diagnosis, but also across different groups in society. So it's a key feature of our recommendation from today's report.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I just take you back to the GP's point? Because I'm a bit at a loss to understand why this is so problematic. I mean, is it because GPs are saying we're so busy getting on with it that we don't have time to record these things? Have health boards asked them of it? Are they saying, you know, our GP saying we are independent organisations and we make our own determination about what our priorities are, or is it at a health board? I mean, why is there such a long-standing problem in finding that information out? I mean, it seems to me that for GPs themselves, who are defending a position when they're quite often under attack at the moment because people feel they're not getting access to them, if they were able to demonstrate with evidence the extent to which they were meeting patient demand, it would serve their cause better than a complete absence of data, wouldn't it?
I think it's a combination of all those factors, Convener, as to why the data isn't. Lee will want to say a bit more, but you know, she specifically mentioned the lack of progress on some new technology. Spire, for example, you know, being one of the anticipated system implementations. But you're right, even some of the innovations we've seen through the pandemic, but Near Me, for example, is changing the way that patients interact with their GP. And typically for almost all of us, that will be the first port of call for health services. All the more reason that, you know, there needs to be a coordinated strategy, progress, that we have robust, reliable data, not just in one sector at a time, but really across our health and social care services. But I think it's a combination of the contributing factors that you mentioned, Convener. But Lee may wish to elaborate further.
Again, not much to add to what the Auditor General has already said. It is a combination of factors, but for example, the Spire, one of the issues that we know with that is that it was up to the practice whether or not they implemented the software that they needed to be able to give that, and fewer GP practices than they had hoped signed up to that, and that was their choice. And so there's lots of problems and challenges involved in trying to get that data from GPs as well. They talk about how busy they are and, you know, entering data manually can be time consuming for them. So it is a whole host of issues that haven't been resolved yet.
Okay, right, thanks. I'm sure ourselves and other committees in the Parliament may well be returning to this point in the future. Can I move on to another area which is of some interest in the report, and that's that whole question about long COVID and long COVID rehabilitation. And I think you point to, I think there are 9 studies to develop the clinical knowledge base for understanding long COVID, which has been funded by the Scottish Government. Could you give us a bit more information about those studies and a bit more, for example, around the timescales for that and, you know, how the results will be reported to the Scottish Government to inform its future decision-making around this area?
I think we'll say as much as we know, Convener, and colleagues can assist me on this. I think we set out in the report that the Scottish Government has announced a £10 million long COVID support fund, building on the surveys that you note, to inform their understanding and their approach to long COVID. And I think it's that understanding point that's coming through in much of the government's commentary on it, that it feels still very early days, that long COVID can refer to a multitude of different conditions and different experiences that patients have from it. Nonetheless, it matters to patients who are affected by it. It's very real and direct, the impact that it's having on their ability to lead a normal life. We haven't done any dedicated audit work on this. We'll continue to track and monitor the government's progress on it. As ever, given the significance of it, and I think linked to the other line of questioning about the clinical prioritisation framework, it matters that it's clear and transparent, that patients can have a clear understanding what services they can get for long COVID, and that they can therefore manage their expectations and what treatment options that they choose to take.
Okay, well, again, I think this is something that we will come back to. You mentioned earlier on, Auditor General, one of the central recommendations of your report is around the very unequal impact that COVID-19 has had. And, you know, if I look at paragraph 58 in the report, you reflect on your report from last year, where you relied on data provided by National Records of Scotland, the Scottish Learning Disabilities Observatory, who concluded fairly starkly, I thought, that those from the most deprived backgrounds and from some ethnic minority backgrounds were more likely to die from COVID-19. Further data has shown that disabled people were more likely to have died from COVID-19. Adults with learning disabilities were also at a greater risk of being hospitalised or dying from COVID-19. I mean, this is quite harrowing, isn't it? And frankly, something of an indictment on our society that this is a feature of the pandemic. You then go on a couple of paragraphs later to say that you've reviewed it again this year and there still is a disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on certain groups, which has led the Scottish Government to addressing this in some measure by focusing on tackling health inequalities. But you then go on to say, but there is still no overarching strategy. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
Yeah, thank you, conveners. It's really stark, and I think the unequal impact that the pandemic has had across society. You rightly mentioned we featured this prominently in our 2020 overview report of the NHS, and we do so again this year. NHS and government's understanding of the impact of the pandemic is increasing. So we note that the government in September of last year published its race equality priorities plan to ensure a more equal and fair recovery from COVID-19 for Scotland's minority ethnic communities. As you also mentioned, that we go on to note that there is still no overarching plan for the government to address all of its equalities requirements and the impact that the pandemic has had on people from Scotland's disabled communities and from those from our more deprived communities. We are clear on the need for the government to develop an overarching strategy so that it better understands the impact of its interventions over the course of this pandemic as part of its preparations into the future. I think it's maybe safe to note a couple of other developments, convener, if I may. The government's plans for a health inequalities unit as part of its overall arrangements to tackle health inequalities, and also the role that Public Health Scotland will be playing in terms of inequalities. Public Health Scotland was set up with this purpose in mind as part of the joint arrangements between the Scottish Government and COSLA. For at the time of its creation, right at the start of the pandemic, it's understandably perhaps focused on the COVID-19 response. As the pandemic ebbs, though, it will have a very clear role too, and part of that will be the development, not just of a strategy. And I think this important thing, and we'll say more about this, is that strategies in themselves are important, but what happens after the strategy, that there are clear plans, that there are measurable milestones and good quality data to assess its implications. None of that detracts from the overall point that we're saying in the report, convener, that there's some still hugely stark disparities of how the pandemic has been felt across the country.
Yeah, thank you. I am going to move on now, and we want to speak a little bit and ask questions around the NHS recovery plan. So I'm going to ask Willie Coffey to come in at this point.
Thanks very much, convener. Stephen, I wanted to talk about NHS recovery, workforce, and try and connect it with the skills issue as well, if I may. I know that the government agrees that innovation and service redesign is essential, and I'm taken back to a predecessor to Bob Black's time when I sat in this committee. I think maybe Colin Beattie was there too. And Bob presented a report like this saying service redesign was essential. And I know there's been a lot of work done since then, from then till now. But you say in your report today, that we're looking at today, there's not enough detail in the recovery plan to give us the assurances that we need about these ambitions and the timescales that might apply. Could you talk a little bit more about that? What kind of information do we need in the recovery plan to help us drive the redesign process forward?
Yeah. Thanks, Mr. Coffey. I'll bring Lee in shortly to say a bit more about the detail of the recovery plans and what's required. you rightly referred to the work of my predecessors and the fact that auditors have been reporting on the need for reform, detail, high-quality data, and the unsustainable nature of the NHS too, that reform is a key component of that. In today's report, and also in my introductory remarks, I noted that the NHS has recently published its workforce strategy, and that was in the report we published that wasn't available. So we note that as a positive contribution, that the government is beginning to set out how it will go about recruiting the necessary staff to support the recovery of NHS services. One thing is perhaps worth noting is that that doesn't accompany with the necessary detail for the Parliament, for users of the NHS to make an assessment as to when they will get the service, the operation that they're looking for. Positively, it does commit to an annual progress update in terms of the workforce strategy and its contribution to the recovery. And that, linked with clear transparency around the national treatment centres, the clinical prioritisation framework, are the steps that we'd expect to see. But ultimately, we know that there's a big backlog. We know that there will be challenges to recover and deliver. But people's expectations and managing those expectations are a key part of the transparency that we all expect. I'll turn to Lee, Mr. Coffey. I'm sure she'll want to say a bit more.
Thank you, Auditor General. When we talk about there not being enough detail, as the Auditor General says, at the time we didn't have the health and social care workforce strategy, so it had some very big ambitions around increasing the workforce, yet very little detail about how they were going to achieve that. So we now have the strategy, but obviously we need a bit more time to make a more thorough assessment of the detail within that strategy. But I think one of the other areas that is key to the recovery plan is the national treatment centres, for example. Yet there's very little detail about how they will operate in practice, and I think we would like to see more detail around, for example, how NHS boards will access those services, and that's what we say in the report as well. You know, back in 2017 we talked about the layers in the NHS and the layers of planning and how it wasn't clear how they would all work together, and I think the national treatment centres will just add to that complexity. So we need more detail about accountability, roles and responsibilities, but also how NHS boards will access those national treatment centres.
Mm-hmm. Before I ask a little bit more about the workforce planning and so on, seeing the whole question about service redesign as it applies to the GP practice experience, do you think we've done a good enough job in taking the public with us in those changes? Because I still get a lot of issues being raised by constituents about access models and the public's expectation that the system we had should be the system that we have going forward. Do you think we've made enough progress in taking the public with us and changing that model for the better?
We're clear in the report, Mr. Coffey, that when transforming services, public bodies have to engage with the public in a meaningful way. So whether they've done that up until now, you know, there'll be various views, I'm sure of it. But the scale of transformation that the NHS requires to move to a sustainable model that prioritises preventative early intervention, some of the changes in technology and innovation that we've seen over the course of the pandemic, whether we'll want to retain those with full equalities impact assessment evaluations of, you know, how they are felt by different groups in society is important. It matters that people feel the changes are relevant to them and they've had their contribution. So we're looking to the future, I think, in today's report, and saying that that's a key part of reform that the public are engaged with meaningfully.
So turning to the workforce issue, we know that there's more staff working in the NHS than there's ever been, certainly since 2006. It's up considerably, but you're still seeing that recruitment is still an issue for us. Is retention an issue in there as well? Are we losing staff from the service? And can we pin that down to COVID particularly? Is the recruitment issue connected with the Brexit issue? Our ability to find and attract the staff to come in to the service? So is our whole recruitment strategy, is it working, or what should we be doing to improve it?
There's a number of components to that, and I'll do my best to cover all of it. I'll bring colleagues in as well. As Lee mentions, the health and social care workforce strategy will be key. So that together with some of the numbers we set in our own report, that the NHS recovery plan identifies the ambitious plans to recruit 1,500 new clinical and non-clinical staff for the national treatment centres by 2026. Significant on top of existing commitments and already vacancies in some NHS disciplines. We've made the comment, Mr. Coffey, also that historically the NHS has struggled to recruit and retain enough staff to meet all of its ambitions. And there are other relevant factors. You mentioned a couple of them, the risk of fatigue and burnout, of staff well-being in the NHS on the back of two incredibly challenging years. And also the impact of the UK leaving the European Union as well. On that last point, I think, as we note in the report, it's probably too early to tell, you know, what the overall impact that Brexit has had on NHS workforce and what that means for the delivery of the future strategy. All of this is saying that there's a huge number of variables going on at the moment for the NHS to get the people that it needs in place to support them so that all of us as users of the NHS can understand when we'll get the treatment services that we're looking for. So the strategy is welcome. What needs to happen now is that there's detailed plans accompany that annual reporting, monitoring in a clear and transparent way.
And lastly, from other work that we've been doing in this committee about skills identification that we've discussed at previous meetings, how does this work? How does this tie in with that strategic approach to skills identification? And I was particularly asking in an Ayrshire context at that particular meeting, how for example, do we demonstrate, do we show, do we identify the skills that we need, for example, in NHS Ayrshire and Arran, to meet the demands going forward? So how do we tie in with these strategic approaches that are happening elsewhere?
Yeah, I'll bring Lee in maybe to support that, but all of the NHS boards will prepare individual workforce plans, you know, and that will be not just for the here and now, but kind of plans into the future, part of their own workforce strategies, culminating in a national strategy, particularly with some of the scale of the changes at the moment makes that all the more important. As you mentioned, Mr. Coffey, that some of the committee's ongoing discussions about skills planning are particularly relevant, not just in an NHS context, but also social care, as we've touched on already today, in terms of the impact and the interconnectedness of delayed discharges, that the success of that plan will be determined the extent to which it applies across a health and social care setting, not just for the recruitment of additional nurses, but that the health and social care across the piece has all the right skills in place. So a key role for the local health board and also for their partners in local government and the third sector, that there is an understanding of the movements between different sectors, and that ultimately patients don't really care. You know, they want the service to be provided to them when they need it to be. They care less about kind of the role in the organisation that the person works for. So I think in overall terms, we're noting progress in the strategy, but that needs to be accompanied by more detail on an individual geographical basis. I'll bring Lee in if there's anything more that she wishes to add.
I guess the only thing that I would add is the work, the NHS and social care workforce strategy that was published is based on what they've called five pillars. So there's plan, which we welcome because it focuses on the workforce data and how they get better data and how they're going to improve their workforce planning, which obviously we've been calling for a number of years. Attract, employ, train and nurture. So again, the training aspect of that is looking at the skills that we need and how are we going to get those skills, whether that's through working with colleges, universities, retraining people, reskilling people to do different things. So there is a focus, I think, in the workforce strategy on the skills that are needed and how we're going to get them. I think the only other thing I would add is obviously with the innovations that we've seen during the pandemic as well, a lot of digital technology, the use of Near Me, and of course the digital strategy that we have as well. There's a big focus in there as well about having people that have the right skills to be able to use that new technology and the new digital advances that we're seeing in the healthcare sector as well.
Just lastly, do you think we're doing enough though to make the public aware that these opportunities are there? Because every year I've been in this parliament, convener, we identify issues about skills, and I represent a constituency where the unemployment levels are always higher than they are in the rest of Scotland. And so looking at this, Ayrshire and Arran, we need these skills for the future to help us redesign the service. Who's closing that gap between skills that are needed within the service and making those opportunities available to local people to fill the gaps? We seem to say every year that the gap is still there. So how do we close it? Is it strategies? Is it documents like this? Is it workforce planning? How does it reach out, though, to the public to draw them in to the services that we need them to fill?
It's undoubtedly complex, probably too complex. Actually, I think that's probably one of the barriers to why it hasn't impacted in the way that ultimately we'd all like to, so that there aren't the historical vacancies and that there are appropriate plans, strategies, real life steps that will recruit and retain the staff that we'll need for health and social care. The committee's spoken in recent weeks about some of the real and immediate challenges in social care. So I think absolutely part of it is about promoting the opportunities, but other fundamental factors too about, you know, fair work, parity between health and social care setting for people who have got the skills that are transferable between those settings. And then some of the longer term planning as well through the important role that of Scotland's colleges, universities play through Skills Development Scotland and their skills programmes as well, that people see this as a long term career option that, you know, will meet their ambitions, give them with a fair work environment and so forth. So I think it's multifaceted. It's probably too early for us to form any judgment about this particular aspect of workforce strategy, but given how central it is to the recovery and reform of the NHS, it's clearly part of our own work, and we'll continue to report on it through this year and beyond.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Thanks, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. I mean, it just occurs to me, are there any health boards or are there any parts of the NHS that carry out any exit interviews to understand why it is people are leaving? You know, is because of retirement, better pay elsewhere, or does any of that go on?
I'll turn to colleagues if we've got any examples to support, convener, but I think it would be my expectation that everybody would have an exit interview when they leave any job, and particularly if, as we're talking about the NHS, that the NHS would want to have that good practice. I think it's been a feature of employment arrangements for decades now, so that intelligence ought to be there and used, I think is the point you're driving at, actually, that it informs employers, the NHS in totality, their understanding of the experience that people have, the reasons for leaving, and ever more important, I think, especially on the back of the past couple of years, that risk of fatigue and burnout, so that they understand what that means for the experience that they're giving people who work in the NHS. But again, I'll ask if Lee or Derek have any other real-life examples that we can share.
I don't have real-life examples because I don't think we haven't looked in detail at what the boards do, but I think through our conversations with Scottish Government, one of the things that we know they are trying to do is to track people's careers so that they understand. So, for example, the 1,500 staff for the National Treatment Centre is obviously one of our concerns, is that those staff will possibly come from NHS boards, so it's almost taking staff out of one place to staff another place. So in our conversations with Scottish Government, they were talking about the fact that they are going to try and track people's career through the system, if you like, but then also if they leave, trying to understand where they are, where do they go, what is it they're leaving for, and how can we prevent that going forward? How can we try and retain them within the system rather than them going somewhere else? So I know that the Scottish Government are doing some work around that. And the other thing they have committed to do in the workforce strategy is to publish, again, annual progress reports. So we welcome that. So hopefully we can keep an eye on the progress that they're making with some of these commitments that are within the strategy.
Thanks. I think that's very helpful, because it is surely about retention as well as recruitment, isn't it? But Colin Beattie's got some questions to ask. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Auditor General, I've got a couple of areas I'd like to cover, neither of which will come as terribly much of a surprise. First one is leadership. And leadership has been discussed and debated in this committee now for many years. Leadership in the public sector and the quality of our leadership. It's absolutely vital that we have the right people in the right place. Now, one initiative that was put in place is the Project Lift Leadership Development Programme. What's the impact of that been on development and retention of leadership in the NHS?
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. I'll ask colleagues to say as much as we're able to about the impact of the project. The intended impact, of course, will have been interrupted by the pandemic, and I think we would also recognise the vital role that leaders play in the NHS, and as you, I think, allude to, the committee's ongoing interest in it. And you know, it's not that long that you held a round table as your predecessor committee about some of the leadership challenges and opportunities within the NHS. And it's equally not that long that we'd commented about the extent of turnover of leaders within the NHS, the extent of vacancies that existed, and the vital role that they play in the delivery of services. We'd also note the real pressure and that leaders in the NHS have been under over the course of the past couple of years, in particular in delivering services in unprecedented context over the course of the pandemic. As we look to the future, particularly the health and social care workforce strategy, yes, it matters that the NHS is able to recruit to support the delivery of the recovery plan, but equally that their plans for leadership, for succession planning, for accountability and effective governance are also there and consistent and well managed. Project Lift is part of that. Whether we're able to say at the moment how successful that's been, I'll turn to colleagues to express a view. But I think it matters that for us that we continue to report and track this as well, that if long-term effective leadership will be vital to the success of the reform of the NHS. But Lee may wish to come in.
Thank you, Auditor General. We didn't look in detail at leadership this year, mainly because it was more stable since our last report. There's only been four new chief executives. Three of those were in national boards, one in a territorial board. So that churn hasn't been the same. I think, as the Auditor General says, we'd probably be more concerned about the resilience of the leadership going forward, having had to deal with everything that they've dealt with through the pandemic, obviously with new policy initiatives coming online, like the National Care Service, putting further pressure on already exhausted leaders. But we didn't look in any detail at the Lift programme, but I don't know if Derek might want to.
No, I think we, to be honest, we kind of struggled to ascertain what impact Project Lift had had. Again, as Lee said, we didn't look at it in a great amount of detail. What we do know is that things are moving on now in terms of leadership support and development. There's a new National Leadership Development Programme that's just kicking off. We're not entirely sure yet of the relationship between Project Lift and that new programme. We're still kind of trying to get to grips on that. I think we'll need to do more audit work in that area to fully understand that. What we do know is that there is a succession planning programme within the NLDP. There has been previous work on succession planning, and again, we're not entirely sure how these two pieces of work relate or come together. So I think there's more work that we need to do there to get to the bottom of this. But as Lee and Auditor General said, there wasn't a particularly strong focus of the report this year. But and it's probably too early for us to really comment too much in this stage. But there are developments there that we need to monitor.
That was part of my next question, was exactly about this brand new work stream that's been put in place, National Leadership Development Programme, and how that fits in with Project Lift, how it complements it, and whether there's a risk of duplication in connection with particularly succession planning in the NHS. But from what you're saying, you haven't really got any answer at this point.
No, yeah, Mr. Vito, no, I think, yeah, definitely more work is needed to understand that. My understanding is that the NLDP will build on Project Lift, so it should, you know, by definition then be complementary. But, yeah, we definitely need to find out a bit more. We need some more information on that, I think.
It is important to know how they're handling leadership succession and so on, because good leadership is absolutely essential for the NHS. Can I ask, just coming back to what the Auditor General was saying in relation to COVID. COVID, of course, is still not gone, and it is still overwhelming some of the hospitals and taking up a huge amount of NHS time. How practical is it bringing in these programmes and trying to make them work in the middle of what is still a crisis? I mean, are we just asking too much, or should they be putting this on all these, well, some of these initiatives of leadership and so on hold until things are more stable?
Mr. Beattie, I think, as we note in the report, that the NHS is still on an emergency footing as a result of the pandemic. Whatever expectations we may have had in November of last year were quickly reset as a result of Omicron. And you know, none of us have a crystal ball as to, you know, what may come next. And it's that balance, I suppose, that of, yes, dealing with the here and now of the pandemic, the emergency footing, which we anticipate will ebb at the end of this month. And then also, I think it is reasonable to look to the future, to think about reform as well as recovery. We're keen to make that distinction, that in our reporting, that it's not a recovery to an unsustainable model, that it's a reform of the NHS to move to a system of health and social care that is preventative, closer to people's homes, less focus on an acute setting, and fewer emergency unplanned interventions, all of that building on high-quality data and so forth. But there are risks involved. You know, I think we've touched a number of times in the committee in recent weeks about other initiatives, the National Care Service in particular, the demands that will place upon the NHS, its capacity, its leadership, to develop its work towards that at the same time as reforming the NHS. The two undoubtedly go, to an extent, hand in hand. But the risk is, of course, is that there are capacity constraints, that, you know, whether it's timelines that drift, or that there's a lack of high-quality data that inhibits planning, milestones, project management and scrutiny. And I think we're touching on all of these points in the report, that as these ambitious plans are taken forward, that there's a reality about what's actually manageable and achievable, given that, as you started off, Mr. Beattie, that we are still in the midst of an emergency footing and a COVID-19 pandemic.
Clearly, leadership is going to be key to managing our way through all this. Let me move on to one of our other favourite areas, which is data, which seems to come up at every other meeting. And we're talking about collecting data here on social care, health and social care, which it's acknowledged that there is poor data sharing and I think difficulties in accessing health records and so forth. There's a lot of issues around this. What timescale does the Scottish Government and COSLA have in developing a data strategy for health and social care?
Well, I'll quickly turn to colleagues. I think we note, I think reasonably, that, before I do that, the Scottish Government COSLA has published a revised digital health and social care strategy in in October. But as you mentioned, that there remain gaps in place for the provision of a collective, robust, reliable data set across primary care, social care, inequalities and workforce. And all of that needs to be captured in a robust, not just strategy, but detailed plans in place that go alongside that, Mr. Beattie. I'll just check in, though, if we have any more detail about when we can expect that.
We're expecting the data strategy later this year. And that will focus both on the availability of data to understand the demand and activity that we've talked about, that there are some gaps in, but also it will also talk about how we can share data as well between different systems, which we've talked about lots of times as well, particularly in our integration report about the lack of sharing of data as well. So we are expecting that later this year.
I suppose an obvious question is, to what extent do you think this is going to improve the collection and sharing of health and social care data? And I know that's a little bit of speculation at this point, but as the Auditor General mentioned, there are clear gaps. Are we satisfied that this strategy is going to cover all that?
I think it reasonably remains to be seen, and as you suggest, Mr. Beattie, we would be speculating. Having said that, I think it's right, and after so many years, so many audit reports and strategies, that we're still talking about data gaps, barriers to sharing data effectively between different public bodies. Feels unacceptable. It feels like we have to move on from this if we are genuinely talking about the reform of public services, the reform of health and social care. This is one of the pillars of allowing that to happen effectively. It's of course welcome that the Scottish Government and COSLA are doing this collectively, and we look forward to seeing it, as Lee mentions, to forming a view on that. But I remain optimistic, Mr. Beattie, that the strategy will be the foundation for which to address some of these long-standing data issues.
An optimistic auditor. Does Audit Scotland have any input into this in terms of the, you've produced reports in the past that you've given historic recommendations and so on? Are these being taken into account on this? Because again, implementation of recommendations and so forth has come up before this committee many times.
Yeah, we have regular engagement with both COSLA local authorities and the Scottish Government in terms of their progress in implementing recommendations, and we report that publicly through our work. As ever, we strike the right balance with in terms of the independent audit function that we provide, and as opposed to providing advice or consultancy, which is the responsibility for the management of these organisations. Having said that, it's important for us through the development of our work and our audit reporting that we understand public bodies' progress and thinking, and we look to do that through regular engagement with public bodies, just to track where they're progressing. As you would expect through our public reporting, and I think given how important this is and how regularly we've been commenting on the data gaps, the importance of quality data to support progress and scrutiny, is very clearly part of our forward work programme.
Thank you very much indeed. The final series of questions that we've got are around NHS finances. And, I was struck by paragraph 115 in the report, where you use the well-chosen words that we're used to from you, Auditor General, where you say the Scottish Government is providing additional support to 6 NHS boards facing a particularly challenging financial position. And you then go on to say that these boards have got to submit monthly plans. So every month, presumably, they have to submit plans that outline savings that they are making. And this is during a period where we are still in an emergency, effectively. Could you tell us, and I know that one of the 6 boards affected is NHS Highland, which has been the subject of a section 22 report, which we considered earlier this year. So I wonder whether you could perhaps reflect on that position and tell us whether your understanding is that their financial positions of these six boards will be improved by the 2022-23 year.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think I would hesitate to be definitive or give you a prediction in terms of the overall financial position that these boards will settle on. The distorting effect of the pandemic has been clear. So in previous years, we regularly spoke about brokerage arrangements that NHS boards would receive and financial difficulties. That then evolved into kind of more medium-term arrangements, financial planning framework, and so forth. To an extent, but not entirely, some of those arrangements have been put aside as the government stepped in over the course of the pandemic to fund health boards' financial requirements so that all boards broke even. I think what we're seeing is an evolution of that, that there is a more targeted focus by the Scottish Government on particular health boards through evaluation of savings plans, longer-term financial position, to make a judgment about how they are progressing towards financial balance. I think a couple of things to note, perhaps, is that the government is planning to review the overall cost allocation model, which will be a feature of the financial position of individual health boards in future. And also that it's rightly still having oversight of individual health boards' progress. You mentioned NHS Highland. The committee has explored the very specifics of NHS Highland, its cost model and so forth, some of the arrangements in terms of delivery of acute services at Raigmore in particular have featured on that. As you would expect, we're continuing to audit the individual health boards. As part of our annual audit, we assess financial sustainability, financial position, and we'll draw on some of the judgments and interaction that the health board are having with the Scottish Government in arriving at that longer-term judgment as we report towards the end of this year.
Okay, thank you. I also, and I'm going to come back to the funding formula, which I think is the subject of some review at the moment, isn't it? But one of the other aspects of the report, which was which set out pretty clearly the financial challenges that the NHS in Scotland faces, was that Exhibit 8, where you which contains a breakdown of funding by key items, and I think you break down in there spending on, for example, drug and medical supplies, the number of the amount that was spent on prescribed drugs in secondary care was £818 million. In primary care, it was over £1 billion was spent on prescribed drugs. There is the spending we know about on PPE, testing kits and further medical supplies and so on. To what extent is the Scottish Government taking into consideration how we expect there to be potentially further inflationary rises or increases in demand, which will lead to a requirement for an increased budget to meet these kind of items?
So the NHS is planning its overall financial position on a long-term basis. And as you touch on, Convener, that there are some existing financial pressures. The pandemic has played a part in that. And then there are now some of these emerging inflationary pressures that we're all seeing in terms of cost of living, and that will feed through to the procurement costs that the NHS will face. In overall terms, that will be for the Parliament and through its consideration of the Scottish budget, any budget revisions that it looks to make. In light of the pandemic and as we emerge from it. If I may, I think one of the point I would make about the sustainability of the NHS, that Audit Scotland has commented in many reports, and we do again this year, about the unsustainable financial position of the NHS, that, as you'd mentioned, that we're seeing, again, a number of boards experiencing financial pressures. But in overall terms, I think for us, this makes the case again for the need for reform to move to a more sustainable delivery model and accompanying financial model that the current challenges in terms of cost of living, inflationary pressures will exacerbate further. So we'll, as I mentioned, Convener, in overall terms, that will be for the Parliament to determine its priorities and for the NHS to manage its resources within whichever allocation it receives.
Thank you. But I mean, the roll call of NHS boards that are in that very tricky financial position includes small boards like NHS Orkney, but also includes NHS Fife, NHS Ayrshire and Arran, NHS Borders, NHS Dumfries and Galloway, and NHS Highland, I mentioned earlier on. So, I mean, this is quite a substantial issue, isn't it? And you did mention that the funding formula was being reviewed, presumably to appreciate whether or not funds are being distributed as effectively, efficiently, and equally in their application as they ought to be. But our understanding is that a date hasn't been set for the completion of that review or an implementation date for that. I mean, are you any wiser about when we are likely to see any changes, what those changes might be, what are the criteria that are driving that review of the funding formula and presumably, therefore, the allocation of funding between different territorial boards, potentially, as well as different tiers of the NHS?
Yeah, I think all those factors are relevant, Convener. I think, as we know, paragraph 118, that the Scottish Government hasn't set a date for this review to be completed. But it's clearly, you know, it's very significant for individual boards, and it perhaps speaks to some of the earlier conversation about staffing, that what to guard against is to, in reviewing the funding formula, that issues of parity are moved from one board to another. That, you know, so through the current NRAC formula, the National Resource Allocation model, is the basis for funding to individual boards is currently allocated, and in evolving from that as I suggest, we don't move from, you know, transferring concerns about overall funding from one place to another, but it is elevated actually as to what the overall financial requirements for health and social care will be in future. So I think this is just one component of it, but I think in overall terms it requires this, a coordinated workforce planning estate strategy that evaluates how health and social care services will be delivered in future.
Okay, well, look, thanks very much indeed. And on that note, I'll draw this session to a close, but thanks very much indeed to you, Auditor General, for the evidence that you've led, to Lee Johnson and Derek Hoy, who've also contributed this morning. It's greatly appreciated. And I will now close the public part of this morning's committee, and we shall go into private session. Thank you.